The evening ended at Andrew Lloyd Webber's flat, where he played Cameron snatches of his new musical, based on a collection of poems by T.S. Eliot, Old Possum's Book of Practical Cats.
Mungo Jerry and Rumpelteazer were a very notorious couple of cats. As knockabout clowns, quick change comedians, tightrope walkers and acrobats.
I felt there was something there. There was some magic in there. So I trotted off to find out if anyone was interested, and so did he. And 3 months later, we both sort of having another catch-up, and there were no bites. A lot of people had said to me, oh, that cat thing was a dreadful idea.
What with the glare of his eyes and his yawning, the peaks and the pollicles quickly took warning. He looked at the sky and he gave a great leap, and they, every last one of them, scattered like sheep. And when the police dog returned to his beat, there wasn't a single one left in the street.
And Andrew just said, look, no one is interested. And I knew by then that this idea had been trotted round everyone, whoever he ever knew in the theatre.
It was very, very hard for Andrew and Cameron to raise the money for the show. And indeed, I think we got into preview without having the last little bit in place. Andrew took a second mortgage on his house. Cameron stumped up everything he could. It was probably the riskiest thing, certainly the riskiest thing they'd ever done, and in my small way, the riskiest thing I had. It's Andrew Lloyd Webber without Tim Rice. T.S. Eliot, the lyricist, has been dead for 20 years. It's the New London Theatre, which hasn't had a hit ever.
Undeterred, Cameron pressed ahead, assembling the creative team. He approached Trevor Nunn at the Royal Shakespeare Company to direct.
I asked Trevor if he would go and meet Andrew, and they had a great meeting, and Trevor told me the next day, though, it was a marvellous meeting, marvellous meeting. But what a shame that Andrew has just talked to me about one of the only bad ideas he's ever had. And so Trevor was not at all convinced about it.
But Cameron's powers of persuasion prevailed. With Trevor on board, they were able to convince classical actress Judi Dench to play the leading role of Grisabella. Boosted by Judy's star power, the show moved from page to stage at breakneck speed.
At the outset, there was no definitive story and there were no assignable characters. I mean, that's a tall order.
There was no script. In fact, the working script was still called Practical Cats. It wasn't until later Trevor said, do you actually need the word practical? Why don't you just call it Cats? And we all went, OK.
The number of people who asked me with an embarrassed smile on their face, doing a show about pussycats? Really?
Cats are not pussycats in my book. They're street animals, they're earthy, they're athletic, and this is a show that is going to be very much about dance.
Britain had never had a successful dance musical. That was Broadway's domain. But Cameron knew choreographer Gillian Lynn could inject the feline sassiness they needed.
Really pull and pull yourself out. Sit and be surprised to see your own leg.
I gave them a long and difficult class every day so that we could find the way to be cats. Because it meant a lot of hard work on the body to change it and make it achieve strange lines and things like that. It's a tough show.
Is everybody here? Is there any rotter hiding behind a seat?
The grueling rehearsals took their toll on the cast. With just 10 days to go before the show's first preview, Judi Dench snapped her Achilles tendon.
Given that you were trying something very different, and then you lose Judi Dench.
Well, she was in hospital. There's lovely pictures of Andrew and I round her bed, gazing woefully at her, sort of bandaging, wishing her to get well very quick.
With Judy out of action, they brought in Elaine Page.
Elaine was very famous. Elaine had that surefire voice. Elaine could dance. There were 10 days left.
Judy was an actress who could sing. Elaine was a singer who could act. The show now needed a hit song to play to Elaine's strength.
I mean, originally, Memory wasn't in the show as we were casting it and putting it together. And the big song was going to be Grisabella the Glamour Cat. That was her peak number. It's a wonderful, haunting song, but it wasn't the pivotal song that the show needed. And Trevor was spot on saying this to Andrew. He said, we need something else.
Andrew Lloyd Webber had one more tune up his sleeve, but no lyrics. So piecing together fragments from T.S. Eliot's unfinished poems, supplied by his widow, Valerie, Trevor Nunn penned the song that would become the show's most memorable number. Memory, all alone in the moonlight, I can smile at the old days, I was beautiful then.
Nobody was sure that it would work because everybody had been telling us it was ridiculous, it couldn't work, you know, a show about cats was ridiculous. Who wanted to see that?
Cats opened at the New London Theatre in May 1981.
On the first night, we bade them good luck and off they went, and we went straight down to the bar and ordered large drinks because we thought that was it and it was going to be a disaster.
At this point, we didn't know if we were actually going to get booed off the stage.
We'd been down there about 10 minutes and we heard the first cheer. And then we listened a bit longer and we heard this real, you could feel the warmth coming, you know. So we crept back up. And the audience was going mad. So we rushed straight back to the bar and had another one to celebrate.
It was an incredible experience, and the world gravitated towards the show because there really hadn't, at that point, been anything like it.
So it became probably your first really massive
hit. Oh, it changed my life. This extraordinary success happened and I was able to pay off my debts. And I realised within 6 months that there was such an international